Today I'm going to be explaining the concept of pulse width modulation and how it relates to microcontrollers of all kinds. I've got an Arduino Nano that I'm using for an example, but this is universal in electronics, and pulse width modulation is really useful for a variety of purposes. Just to familiarize you with some basic concepts first, quite often you want to produce some sort of an analog signal. You know, in its simplest example, maybe you just want to produce a DC signal. So for those of you who are familiar with electricity, you know, batteries and other, you know, very basic electronic stuff, everything's measured in terms of voltage it needs or the voltage it provides. Like if it's a battery, you know, an alkaline battery has 1.5 volts, lithium ion battery is 3.7, USB is 5. And a lot of the devices that you use every day, your cell phone, and all sorts of other things, require a fixed voltage to operate properly. So basically, voltages are kind of arbitrarily produced by electronics, but you know how exactly is usually it's not obvious to most people. In the digital world, and most devices are digital. You can't really control what sort of voltage output you get. It's either high or low because everything is binary. You might have heard that term before. Binary just simply means that there's only two states that a simple electronic device can take. You know, positive, negative, true, false, high, low, 0 and 1. So pretty much that's a consequence of how nonlinear circuits work. Like you've got diodes, you've got transistors, and they're all just different forms of electrical gates or switches. So when you gate or switch something, you can either have it on like this, or it's off. And when it turns off, it drops right down to zero. Let's just call this zero, and let's just call this 5 volts for the sake of example here. So if you want something like 2.3 volts, you can't get that using switches. Switches don't have the ability to do that. I mean, there are amplifiers, and amplifiers are able to augment, you know, voltages, but the internal circuitry is complicated, so it's, you know, at its very most basic level, you just can't get analog signals from digital components. So the way that you get around this is by using pulse width modulation. There are other methods, of course, but pulse width modulation is one of the most popular and convenient to use. Basically, you just produce a square wave, and a square wave is nothing more than a bunch of on and off repeating events like this. You turn the switch on, you turn the switch off, you turn it on, you turn it off, and you get a bunch of repeating voltage spikes that graphically would look like a bunch of repeating bars. So when you have a bar, this is on and then it turns off and it goes down to zero, and then it turns on and stays on for a while, turns off, goes back to zero. And by doing this, you create a very abrupt change in voltage level, and it's still only either 0 or 5 volts, so you're not there yet. But what you can do is use analog components that are designed for filtering, like capacitors, for example. You put a capacitor in parallel with a signal like this, and the capacitor will basically lag behind the voltage signature. So it'll take time for the voltage going into the capacitor to affect the capacitor's voltage. So what it ends up doing is kind of smooths out the signal, and you end up getting something like this coming out of your capacitor, because the capacitor can't respond to the voltage fluctuations in the amount of time that the digital components can produce them. So by using larger and larger capacitor values in terms of their farad value, you can damp this signal out to the point where it's no longer even recognizable as a square wave, certainly, but even as a sinusoidal wave. It starts to turn into like basically a straight line. And a straight line is nothing more than a DC signal, which is what you wanted in the first place. So a lot of digital to analog converters rely on the principle of taking a digital signal and filtering it to the extent that it's no longer a repeating pattern, but it's just a simple fixed value. So by using pulse width modulation, you can get an analog signal, or what's a very close approximation to an analog signal. Now, from that point there, all you need to do is figure out how long you need to turn the pulse on, because the longer you turn the pulse on, the more energy there is, because there's more voltage. And if you turn it off only for a brief instant and then turn it back on again, you're on so much of the time that the average of the voltage that you're producing is fairly high. So when you damp that out, it's going to approximate, you know, a pretty large voltage. So the average would be, you know, up here. But if you, I'm just going to clear the board here. If you do the opposite of that, if you have your wave, your pulse is only coming on for a very brief amount of time, and they're off the rest of the time, the frequency doesn't change. You're still producing pulses at the same rate. They're just on for a lot less time. And because of that, the average, the area under the curve, if you will, the average of the voltage is much lower. So you end up getting an approximation that ends up being a lower voltage. So basically, you change this pulse time, which is referred to as a duty cycle. You change the amount of time that the pulse is on, so you change the duty, and that gives you either a higher or lower voltage depending on whether you have the pulses on for a longer time or a shorter time, respectively. So that's how you achieve, you know, an approximation of analog signals using digital discrete components. And the Arduino and many other microcontrollers, being controllers based off of digital logic, they have a lot of digital I/O, which is like in or out. That's what that stands for. And those I/O pins can produce high and low voltage signals at some value, either 3.3 volts or 5 volts, some fixed value. And you can use the principle of pulse width modulation to turn those digital signals into analog ones by using this methodology. The code that runs the Arduino boards is already set up for that, because you've got a built-in functionality for producing pulse width modulated signals. So all you have to do is issue the right command, and you can get pretty much any voltage you want. So let's have a quick look at the code to see how you would set something like that up. So now that you understand a bit of the theory behind pulse width modulation, let's have a quick look at the board itself. This is a nano board, but the architecture is exactly the same as an Arduino Uno. So if you have an Arduino Uno, it'll look physically different because the pins are, you know, spread apart and in sockets, and, you know, it's more of a square board, but this is exactly the same. It's got the same pinout configuration to it. You'll notice that along the left-hand side here, you've got all these pins labeled D2 through D12, and then on the right-hand side, you've got some analog pins. These are all input pins. They're meant to take in analog signals and convert them to digital ones. So for the purposes of what we'll be doing with pulse width modulation, we're going to be using the digital pins, because the digital pins produce those 5 volt signals that are either on or off, and we can put into the code a timing algorithm to tell the program how long to turn the pin on and how long to turn it off, so that the ratio of on to off time, which represents the duty, if you'll remember, so that ratio gives us the percentage of the maximum voltage that we want. So if we want, 2.5 volts, that's a 50% duty cycle of the maximum 5 volts. So the way the architecture is laid out, we're going to be using timers to do this. There's 3 distinct timers on an Arduino board of this kind. The timers basically do nothing but count from zero to some maximum value, and then they can do different things. They can count back down again, they can repeat, but basically all they are is counters. And we're going to use these counters because they're all timed based on a crystal timing device, which is located here. The whole board runs off of a 16 megahertz processor, and the frequency comes from a crystal, and that frequency is basically the master key to determining all the timing operations of everything on the entire board, including the timers. So try to think of it this way. Your clock frequency of 16 megahertz means that there's 16 million events happening per second. That's the rate at which instructions can be executed. You basically have those 16 million events at your disposal in 1 second. So if you're using 512 of them just to divide up each pulse into pieces, that means that you only have 16 million divided by 512 as your maximum possible pulse width modulation frequency. So how frequently the bars occur is limited to that number, because each bar is subsequently divided into 512 pieces. So you have to factor that 512 out of your maximum frequency in order to get the frequency at which your bars can repeat. So it turns out that that number is approximately 31,000. 16 million divided by 512 is 31,000. 512 is arbitrary. I picked that number because I wanted that much resolution for my pulse width modulation, but you can pick 256. You can pick other numbers for your resolution. If you don't need as much resolution, you can get a higher PWM frequency. But for the purposes of this example, I chose 512 for my resolution, so my duty cycle resolution, and that leaves me with 31 kilohertz as my maximum switching frequency. And there's a reason why I want to use the maximum. I want to use all the frequency I can get. It's a lot easier to filter signals when they're at a high frequency. What I mean by that is high frequency signals, they change so rapidly that it's hard for capacitors to keep up, so that capacitors with smaller values can more easily filter high frequency signals. If you want to filter a low frequency signal, you need a large capacitor to do that, because the extra capacity in that capacitor is going to slow down the voltage fluctuations. So for a high frequency signal, you don't need as much effort to damp that out, because it's changing so rapidly that it's really easy to filter it. There's not much not much damping required to get that to flatten out. It's a little bit difficult for me to explain in words, but that's how it basically works. So your board, your device that you're using your Arduino to make your analog signal for, can be simpler, can be smaller, more compact if you use a high frequency. So now I'm going to move on to talk about the board itself and how the configuration of the PWM works. You'll notice here that you've got digital pins on the left-hand side denoted by D's, analog input pins denoted by A's. These are only input pins. You can't get analog out of these pins, but we're going to use the digital pins on the left to do what the analog inputs can't, which is to output an analog signal. There are three timers on the Arduino. By the way, this is an Arduino Nano, but it's identical in architecture to the Arduino Uno, so if you have an Uno, this all applies. There are three timers on this chip, and timers basically do nothing but count from one number to another at the same speed as the clock. So all it does is just count integers from 0 to 100, from 0 to 10,000, whatever the number might be. It just counts, and then you can program it to do something when it reaches a certain number. So each timer is assigned to a different group of pins. The pin I want to use is pin 9, which belongs to timer 1. So I'm going to be using timer 1 to produce my 31 kilohertz signal. And that 31 kilohertz signal is going to propagate onto pin number 9. And because I've got a duty resolution of 512, 512 is going to be a significant number, because when the timer counts up to 512, it's going to have to know to end that pulse width and produce a repeating pulse after that. So it's going to be a significant marker. So basically the way that you configure a timer is through registers. And registers are, in the architecture, they're physically burned into the chip itself, but the way you control them is through the software. So a register is nothing more than a block of memory that is specifically assigned through the design of the chip to control a certain feature of the chip. That's part of the architecture of the chip. So you can control the hardware by means of changing these special registers that are located in special memory areas. And you can do that by issuing commands in the Arduino code. So there are only a couple of registers that are of significance that we need to calibrate before we can run the program and get the PWM. So I'm going to go over those now and explain what each of them do, and where they are, and what their names are, and what values they need to take. So I just want to touch on the idea of registers and how that kind of works. What you're looking at here is the actual data sheet for the ATmega328P, which is basically the CPU, if you will, of the Arduino board. Everything about that chip and how to operate it is in this massive document. You can find it on the internet as a PDF very easily if you just type ATmega328P. This particular section here shows one of the registers that we need to change. In this case, it's called TCCR1A. The 1 stands for timer 1, in case you're wondering what that's for. The rest of it, that we don't really need to explain at the moment. This is what the register kind of looks like if you were to represent it textually. It's a byte in memory. A byte is a collection of 8 bits. And you can see that there's 8 segments to this block, from 0 all the way up to 7. If you count that, there's 8 of them. And each bit has its own name. So you can change the entire register at once, or you can change each individual bit, so it's very configurable. And each bit has a different meaning in terms of what part of the timer it controls. So we need to change this register, and we also need to change another register further down, which is TCCR1B, and that's again got several different bits in it, each with their own individual names. And the individual bits themselves, you can see there's tables all over the place with ones and zeros. Those tables tell you, you know, if you flip, for example, this bit here, bit number 3, called WGM12. WGM12 is here. If you flip that bit to a 1, and you flip all the other bits, you know, in the same row here, according to these values, it tells you what sort of mode you select. So what we are looking for is actually called fast PWM 9-bit. That's my mistake. If you do the math, 2 to the power of 9 is 512. That's the resolution I wanted for my PWM. So 9-bit corresponds to a 512 resolution for the PWM. So in order to get 512, or resolution of 512, we need to have a 0110 configuration for WGM 13 through 10. So 13, 12, 11, 10, those bits need to be assigned to 0110. And that's called mode 6, fast PWM 9-bit. So basically that'll count from 0 to 512 and go back to 0 again. And it'll do that at 16 megahertz, which means that it'll count to 512 and reset to 0 31 some odd thousand times, and that's where you get the 31 kilohertz PWM frequency from. So this is the mode we want, 0110 for the WGM bits. And up here we've got bits called COM1A, COM1B1, COM1A0, and COM1B0. If we set both of these bits to... Sorry, I'm in the wrong table here. I'm looking for this one, Fast PWM. You can see it says Fast PWM here. So I want non-inverting mode, which is here. Non-inverting mode simply means that when you ask for a high, you get a high, instead of asking for a high and getting a low. It might sound stupid, but sometimes you actually want that. In my case, I don't. So I'm going to have a 1 and a 0 for non-inverting mode for those bits. And then finally, there's three other bits that need to change right here. CS10, CS11, and CS12. These basically select the prescaler. And what a prescaler is simply another factor that you can divide your clock frequency by in order to get, in order to reduce or increase precision of your counting. So in my case, I want the fastest possible frequency for my PWM, so I don't want to reduce my clock speed by any kind of a factor. You can reduce your clock by factor of 1, factor of 8, 64, 256, or 1024, or by another arbitrary value. I don't want to do that because I want to get the fastest possible speed out of my CPU. All this does is slow your CPU down, you know, in case you need to do that. So for me, I want a factor of 1, which means it stays the same. So that's a 0, 0, 1 for CS12, 11, and 10 respectively. Now if we quickly go to the code, you can see here I've defined pin number 9 as an output, because that's the pin I want my PWM on. I've defined the entire register TCCR1A and TCCR1B to 0. That means all bits in those registers are cleared to 0. It's a good idea to do that because it makes sure that whatever you select is, if you forgot to select something, it's not going to be some arbitrary value. You'll know that it's going to be a 0. So it's just a safe thing to do at the beginning. This block here is to set the prescaler. You'll recall that those were the CS bits. So I wanted 001 with CS10 equal to 1. So I've set that. TCCR1B is the register name, and CS10 is the bit in the register. And I'm setting that to 1. Waveform generation mode 6. If you recall, that's the fast PWM with 9 bits of duty resolution, and that was a 0110. I've commented out the zeros because I don't really need to declare them as 0, they're already 0, but I'm just showing them here just so that you know that they exist. WGM 13, 12, 11, and 10. The table told us to put 0110, so I did that. Finally, you have to make sure that you get the registers right. So WGM 12 belongs to register B, WGM 11 belongs to register A. Don't mix those up. Finally, you've got the COM1A1, COM1A0, COM1B1, and COM1B0. The combination for that was 1010, and that gives you your non-inverting waveform. Now, the only other thing that I left out was these two variables called OCR1A and OCR1B. I'll just focus on OCR1A for now. This is basically going to define your duty cycle. It basically marks a point between 0 and the top of your duty resolution. In my case, is 512. It marks some point between there where you want the wave to turn either on or off, depending on whether you have it in inverting or non-inverting mode. So in my case, I want the wave to be on for 50 out of 512 clock pulses. and I want it to turn off after 50 and then remain off until the next cycle. So by changing the value of OCR1A, you can effectively change your duty cycle without changing the frequency of your PWM. So think of OCR1A as a placeholder for the number that you're the number that you're picking that's going to control the fraction of your duty cycle, and therefore the voltage you get out, your analog voltage out. So remember, you only can get 0 or 5 volts on a digital pin, but anything in between is going to define what the analog signal is going to be once you filter it. So you're going to start out with a square wave, and once you filter it, it's going to turn into a DC signal. So if you want 1 volt, you can only have 0 or 5, you need a 20% duty cycle. 20% of your maximum voltage is going to give you 1 volt. 20% of 5 volts gives you 1 volt. So 20% duty cycle, your duty is, you know, is 512. So 20% of that, and you can do the math and figure out what that is. 20% of 512 is the number that you should put in here to get your pulse to turn on only 20% of the time for each pulse duration. And that's going to give you a square wave, which when filtered will approximately equal 1 volt. So depending on the voltage you want, you're going to have to include that in your program and calculate that on the fly and figure out what integer number you need out of your total. So this loop function down here, all this does, it's just for visualization purposes. I'm going to demonstrate it in a moment. All this does is ramp the duty from 0, which it starts at, up to 511. Don't forget, everything in computer language starts at 0. So 512, the last number is actually 511 because 0 is included. So all this does is go from 0 to 511, and then from 511 it goes back to 0 again because we start subtracting 1 after each loop. So this is going to go from 0 to 511, from 511 back to 0, and it's going to keep doing that forever. And what you're going to see is you're going to see a square wave that starts out very skinny, gets fatter until it's completely filling the screen, until it's like, you know, until the voltage is 5 volts across the board, and then it's going to start getting skinnier again until it's 0 volts. And when you filter it, that's going to give you a voltage that, an analog DC voltage that ranges from 0 volts to 5 volts smoothly. And you're not going to see any, or you're going to see very, very little ripple, which is what you want for an analog signal. So now let's put the code on the chip, on the Arduino, and run it. And we'll hook up an oscilloscope to it. An oscilloscope is just a device used to visualize and measure signals. And we'll see what it visually is going to look like, and you'll see how it relates back to the material we were discussing before. Okay, so this is a very, very old oscilloscope. Forgive me, I couldn't find anything better to demonstrate on. The grid lines represent whatever you set the dials to. So if you set the dials to, in this case, it's 20 microseconds per division, it means that each square on this grid represents 20 microseconds. So along the horizontal x-axis, each square is 20 microseconds of time. Here I've got the voltage set to 100 millivolts per division, and there's some attenuation through the cable. It's like a resistor in the cable to drop the voltage down. So just have to trust me that this actually means that, you know, the size of this wave is actually ranging from 0 to 5 volts, even though it may not look like it visually, but it does. And what you're looking at right now is the effects of the code that I explained earlier. So the code is designed to change the duty cycle from 0% to 100% and then back to 0%. So what you can see here is that the lower line that is growing and shrinking, that's always 0 volts. And all it's doing is growing between a minimal amount of time at that voltage and maximum amount of time at that voltage. And as it grows, the bar at the top shrinks correspondingly. The bar at the top represents 5 volts. So the sum of the two bars is always the same, meaning that the frequency of the PWM doesn't change. It's always 31 kilohertz, but the ratio of off time to on time does change. By the way, the fact that you see the entire image kind of moving around, that's noise in the system. You can ignore that. It's not part of the demonstration. The only part of the demonstration is the horizontal bars that you can see growing and shrinking. So what I'm going to do now is connect a capacitor. I've got a capacitor. It's a rather large one here. I think it's 47,000 microfarads. And I'll go back to looking at the scope for a second. So you'll see that as soon as I touch the capacitor, the wave changes drastically. It's no longer a square wave, as you can see. You might be able to detect the very, you know, small residual square wave effect. Like, you can probably see some lines moving around that aren't part of the main line. The filtering isn't perfect, it's not 100%, but it's a pretty much taking out all the AC component and just leaving you with the DC component. There's still some noise causing the image to move around, but the mostly what you're seeing is that up and down movement. That's actually the PWM at work. That's not noise. So when the line moves up to the top of the screen, that's because the on time is at a maximum. And when the line moves down to the bottom of the screen, that means that the on time is at a minimum. The duty cycle is at a minimum. So we've basically taken a discrete digital component that produces only two voltage values, 0 and 5 volts, and we've processed it into such a form that now it's an analog, it's a continuous analog signal that you can adjust between 0 and 5 volts, which is extremely handy because a lot of devices require their power to be throttled. Sometimes they take really weird voltages that no battery can supply or no digital component is readily available to supply. So being able to move the voltage around like this between two extremes is extremely important in electronics. And this is a really, really easy way of accomplishing it. And there's nothing crude or dumb about this. I mean, as you can see, it's pretty clean. The signal is nice and straight. So you could totally use this for, you know, sensitive electronics that need a specific voltage value without having to worry about causing damage or anything like that. As long as you use the right filtering components, as long as you take care to design your circuit correctly, it'll work just fine. So I'm just going to disconnect that capacitor again. I'll do it when the wave is at the very bottom, and you'll notice that the PWM is, you see that? So the PWM had the skinniest bars when the wave was at its lowest point. So let me just try again. I'll wait until the bottom bars are at their widest point, which means that the wave is almost off. See? So it's at a minimum right now, and that's when the bars are at their widest. Or maybe I should have said it the other way around. If you look at the 5 volt lines, which are the top lines, when they get to their maximum width, it means that you're getting the most voltage. And when you get the most voltage, the DC line should be at its highest point. So right now. And then you can see it goes down from there until there, right? So despite the noise on the oscilloscope, you can still see the correlation between the width of the bars and the DC component that you get out of it. It does correlate pretty strongly. So thanks for watching. Like, subscribe, comment, and I hope this helps you guys and your microcontroller projects.